knowest when I sit down and when I rise up. Thou discernest my thoughts from afar. Thou searchest out my path and my lying down, and art acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, lo, Lord, thou knowest it altogether. Thou dost beset me behind and before, and layest thou hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain. Now we will have our second scripture. It is from Philemon, verses 1 through 21, and it's on page 1043 of your pew Bible. Prisoner for Christ, Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our beloved fellow worker, and Apia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers, because I hear of your love and of the faith which you have toward the Lord Jesus and all the saints. And I pray that the sharing of your faith may promote the knowledge of all the good that is ours in Christ. For I have derived much joy and comfort from your love, my brother, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you. Accordingly, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do what is required, yet for love's sake I prefer to appeal to you. I, Paul, an ambassador, and now a prisoner also for Christ Jesus, I appeal to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become in my imprisonment. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful to you and to me. I am sending him back to you, sending my heart, my very heart. I would have been glad to keep him with me in order that he might serve me on your behalf during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I prefer to do nothing without your consent in order that your goodness might not be by compulsion, but out of your own free will. Perhaps this is why he was parted from you for a while, that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, as a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, receive him as you would receive me. If he has wronged you at all, or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, write this with my own hand. I will repay it, to say nothing of your owing me even your own self. Yes, brother, I want some benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I write to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. It's the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The now same first verse of Jesus' lesson, as our youth come forward.
Some slaves, and Onesimus, close, Onesimus, was a slave for Philemon, and one day he ran away, and he went to where Paul was. And Paul and him actually became friends, and Paul converted him to Christianity, so he is now a believer. But back in those times, the Roman law required that if you had a slave that ran away, if you found them, it gave you the right to kill them, actually. So I don't think probably Onesimus wanted to run right back to Philemon, probably. He was probably a little worried. So Paul wrote a letter for him to take back, which was what Jean read to you this morning in the scripture, and kind of telling Philemon that Onesimus was a different person now, that he's now a child of God, just like all of us, and that, instead of him coming back to be murdered or to be treated badly, he should be treated not even as a slave anymore, but as a brother in Christ, because he will now be able to go out and share all of the good news of Christ to everyone and to help do missionary work and things like that. So, really, I think this whole story is about kind of forgiveness. I mean, it's hard to forgive people, right? I mean, there's people who maybe can say and do and embarrass you and make you feel inadequate or things in your life. I know I had my share of that too, where you get your feelings hurt and the one thing that you want to do is maybe hold a grudge or try to get even or try to embarrass them. One of the things that we don't initially turn to, though, is thinking about forgiving them. You know, it takes a lot of energy to hate someone. It takes a lot less energy to love someone. And if you're carrying hatred around, it kind of weighs your whole body and it consumes you. That's all you want to think about, that's all you can kind of concentrate on, how you're going to be even, or how you can plot people against the other person or whatever, instead of just letting that situation go. And I know it's taken me a lot of years to be able to even try and do that, but it's really what Jesus wants us to do. Jesus came to this earth and he forgave people, because there's really not one of us who probably hasn't done something in our life that we need to be forgiven for. So we have to remember that. And it just takes a lot of energy. So if you're going to forgive someone, truly do forgive them. Don't keep it in the back of your mind. Just say, this is over, this is past, let's move on. Because a lot of times, some of those people who are out there doing the most hurtful things are people who also have lots of issues inside. And maybe, I'm not telling you you have to be their best friend, but just truly try to move on from that situation and forgive. Okay, let's say a prayer.
Dear God, help us in difficult situations,
to remember your son,
and his forgiving qualities.
Amen.
Thank you for that, John. A lot of times I feel like John does that children's song like that. I should just follow up and elaborate on that again. Because that is, really, this is about relationships and about thinking about forgiveness, which is very important. I just want to mention sort of a study in extremes today, when we had the scripture that was read by Gene. And Gene gives her the scripture, didn't care how it's pronounced, whatever it is, just say it, because like I know that no one knows how to pronounce his words anyway. Joan came to me this morning, how do you pronounce this? How do you do this? I'm going to get this wrong. I know it's going to be wrong. But anyway, so it was as right as anybody else. We do run into a few names here that are names that we're not familiar with any longer, and their pronunciations can be whatever. But this little book, that I will pronounce Philemon, because that's what I heard in seminary. All my life I heard it as Philemon. This is Philemon, I thought. But How often do you hear of Philemon or Philemon anyway? Not very often, even if you're in church all the time, because actually my message this morning is going to be based on the entire book of Philemon. And that is because it's a very short book. As a matter of fact, it's one of five books in the Bible that is only one chapter long. It's one of the shortest books. It's not the shortest book in the Bible, but it's one of the shortest books in the Bible. So I should have probably done this on Short Service Sunday. I can't because there's so much good material in here. And by the way, this is a lectionary scripture for today. So there's so much good material here because this book, by the way, 3 John is the shortest book in the Bible if you want to compare it. Try to find the shortest one. You need to read something real fast. 3 John is the shortest book of the Bible. But anyway, Philemon, it is, even though it's so short, you know, you heard almost all of it. There were just the last two or three verses that we left off of the reading this morning, which is basically just Paul signing off, whatever, there at the end. So it's only 25 total verses long. And if you look at your bulletin, you see it says Philemon 1 through 21. You might think, well, wait a minute, that's not how you designate things in the Bible. You've got to put the chapter there first, and then you put the number of verses. Well, not if it only has one chapter. That is correct. That's not a misprint in the bulletin. It's just Philemon verses 1 through 21, because there are only 25 total verses in Philemon. There is no chapter 2, so you don't have to say chapter 1. So there's just a little bit of Bible trivia for you if you want to know. In this particular book, Paul is writing a letter to his friend Philemon, which is a gentleman mentioned to us this morning. And he's writing about this other person, Onesimus. And we're going to hear a little bit about him this morning. But what this letter really does, it gives us a glimpse into Christian relationships. And yes, it does involve forgiveness. It involves love. It involves mercy. And there is an awful lot that we can learn from this very small book of Philemon if we unpack it a little bit and look at it a little closer. Because it really is telling us a lot about how the gospel deals with relationships. And how, if we really believe in the gospel, how that should change the relationships that we have with one another and with God. Shall we pray? Gracious God, may the words of my lips and the meditations of our hearts and minds be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This really isn't a sad book. If you see tears rolling down my face, it's allergy season. And my allergies are pretty much under control, except for the eyes. And so they continue to water occasionally. I'll try not to rub them all on over here as well. There are three main people, as I mentioned, that are featured in the book of Philemon. Paul, who is the author. Philemon, who is the intended recipient of this particular letter. And Onesimus, who is a mutual acquaintance of both Paul and Philemon. So, I want to mention a little bit about each one and talk about the relationship that we can see from this letter that exists between them and how that is impacted and affected by the life of Jesus Christ in each of these people. First, Paul. We know a lot about Paul. He really is the author of more of the New Testament, more of the Bible, actually, than anyone else that we are aware of. We know how the gospel of Christ changed Paul's life completely. He was first known as Saul, we first hear of him in the Bible, and he was a violent persecutor of Christians and persecutors of the church in first century Rome. But then the Lord called Paul through a very extraordinary occurrence. Paul was converted, and he went from being a persecutor to a preacher. He went from being an enemy of the gospel to an actual apostle of the gospel. And he becomes perhaps what many claim to be the greatest preacher, the greatest teacher, maybe even the greatest theologian, definitely the greatest missionary that the Christian church has ever known. made such a big change in Paul's life that he himself was then willing to be persecuted just as he had persecuted others and thrown many people in prison in his earlier life as Saul. He was willing to suffer those same kinds of indignities in his own life in the name of the gospel. And so it was, as Joe mentioned, he was actually found himself in jail or in prison many times during his ministry and his missionary journeys all around the Mediterranean world at that time. And it was that this time when Paul was arrested and taken to Rome, and he was in prison there for a very long period of time, actually, that we believe this letter was being written when Paul was in prison in Rome. And he writes this letter to Philemon. And we believe it was around the year 60 or so. Now, while under arrest in Rome, Paul was able to receive visitors. And we believe it was during the time that he came in contact with this fellow named Onesimus. Onesimus had come to Rome from Colossae, a city in Western Asia Minor, which what is Turkey today. And Onesimus came to Rome as a runaway slave. He had been enslaved for whatever reason. We don't know why that he was a slave, but it was a common practice in the Mediterranean world at this time for people to own slaves, to have slaves, and for slaves. It was just a part of their society. He had left Colossae, however, he got away, and he had run away to the big city of Rome as a good place to hide out, and probably thought he was completely safe there. Now, when I say Onesimus was a slave, I think we have to be careful and don't automatically start thinking about roots and kunta kinte. Maybe I'm dating myself with that, some of you may not have ever seen that. But thinking of American slavery in pre-Civil War days here in the United States. In the ancient Greco-Roman world, a slave was not necessarily a slave for life. They weren't born into it and died as a slave necessarily. And they were not necessarily harshly mistreated either. As a matter of fact, a lot of times slaves came into people's households to serve them originally, but then became a very valued member and a part of that household. If a slave proved to be trustworthy, they could be given a good deal of responsibility, and eventually, as I said, they probably would become free and would become a free member of the society that they had been enslaved in. It's not the kind of slavery that we picture here as being so harsh and difficult. However, if you were a slave and you disobeyed what your master told you to do, or you showed him to be untrustworthy by doing something like running away, then the penalties could be pretty harsh for you. And as Joan pointed out, you could even have been put to death if you were known to be a runaway slave or shown to be a runaway slave. Certainly, you could expect to be punished fairly harshly for being a runaway slave. So that's the situation that Onesimus was in when he meets Paul in Rome and when he converts to Christianity and learns the gospel. They came to know each other, we don't know how, but they didn't have it, and Onesimus became a Christian because of Paul's influence. And that relationship as a really a mentor, as a Christian mentor to Onesimus, was really the relationship between Paul and Onesimus. Paul sort of became his spiritual father. He's the one that led Onesimus to Christ. So Paul really regarded Onesimus as one of his spiritual children, if you will, a child in God, a part of the family of God. And that's why I think in our text, Paul refers to Onesimus as my child. He wasn't Paul's physical child. Paul was not married. Paul had no children of his own. But he did come to feel that many people that he had brought up in the gospel were like his children. And he certainly loved them like children. And Onesimus certainly fell into that category based on what it says in this letter. There was clearly a very warm personal relationship between Paul and Onesimus. So Paul came to feel toward Onesimus sort of as a father would toward his son. So in there he calls Onesimus my very heart because of that relationship that they had. But now, what would become of Onesimus? Paul evidently has convinced Onesimus that he needs to return. As a runaway slave, he needs to return to his former owner or master. That's the right thing to do, I guess, because that decision obviously has been made, and Onesimus is preparing to return to Colossae to Philemon. But he's a runaway slave. What's going to happen to him when his master sees him and when he returns? Well, it just so happens, obviously, here in this particular scenario, in this situation, in this book, that Paul also knew Philemon. He had been in Colossae. He had set up a church in Colossae. And Philemon actually had become a Christian and was a part of the Christian church that Paul had set up in Colossae. Paul got around a lot in the Mediterranean world during his time. Like I said, he was undoubtedly the greatest missionary the world has ever known. He established more churches in more different places than anyone else. Of course, there weren't any churches when he began. So he had a sort of a blank slate world to go to. And almost every place he went, he established a Christian church because there wasn't one there previously. Well, he established a Christian church in Colossae. Philemon became a part of that church, was himself a believer in the Christian gospel. So, Paul is sending Onesimus back to Philemon, the master from whom he ran away, and Paul is interceding for Onesimus. And in Paul's intercession, I think we learn a lot about relationships, particularly relationships between Christians. Paul seems to be counting on the power of the gospel to change the relationship between Philemon and Onesimus. Remember, they are master and slave. That's what they are. That's who they are to each other, what they have been in past years. But now, Paul sees them both as brothers in Christ because of the gospel, because both of them, the gospel has transformed and changed their lives. And Paul writes that he wants Philemon to have Onesimus back no longer as a servant, but more than a servant, as a beloved brother. That brotherly bond in Christ is going to transform the relationship between Philemon and Onesimus. And this transforming power of the gospel also shapes how Paul talks to Philemon in this letter. The way he addresses and talks to Philemon, because they also are fellow brothers in Christ. But remember, Paul is like the one standing up here preaching to you all. He has been the preacher in the church. He has been the spiritual leader at the church of Colossae. So spiritually, he feels like, or you might think, that he has some kind of authority, you know, over the members of that particular church. That's why I made the statement I did at the beginning. I don't have any authority over you all. This is your church. It is not my church. And that's, Paul is saying that. He's saying, you know, you might think I have some special authority over you, and that I can order you to be nice to Onesimus. But he's saying, no, that's not right. He said, I'm not going to coerce you to take care of Onesimus, to treat him well, to not punish him. He said, that's not it. He said, I hope that your knowledge of the gospel and the life of Jesus Christ will show you the way that you should treat Onesimus. But it has to be your own decision. It can't be mine, Paul's decision for you. So it's very interesting, the relationship that's taking place here. Paul is putting himself on the same plane as Philemon and Onesimus, and saying we're all just brothers in Christ. How should we treat each other? How should we care for one another? And he's posing that, I think, not just to Philemon, But he's posing that to all of us as Christians as well. Love, mercy, grace, forgiveness. To Christians, these should not just be words on a page or words spoken from a pulpit on Sunday morning. These should be realities in our lives. These are the ways in which we should be treating our brothers and sisters, our other members of the family of God, because we are a family. We live in close relationship. But we're not without sin. We're not perfect people. We all mess up sometimes. We all, at some point, are going to hurt somebody else's feelings, step on somebody else's toes, do or say something that are in some way or the other is going to offend our brother or sister. If you haven't done it already, you're going to. And so am I. That's who we are as human beings. We are imperfect people. But we're still family. Even though we hurt each other from time to time. But as Christians, we also know the reality of forgiveness. We ourselves have received forgiveness from God, or we wouldn't be here gathered as a Christian family. If you don't realize that God has forgiven you, you wouldn't be here on this Sunday morning. And that knowledge that God has forgiven us as an imperfect person, that we ourselves have received forgiveness, that's how we learn to forgive each other. We know the importance of restored relationship because through Jesus Christ we have a restored relationship with our God. God has restored us back to himself through the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So you can see, if you look at this letter and try to dissect it and hear what Paul is saying, that Paul writes to Philemon, the love and grace that Paul himself had learned from Jesus Christ, this should be extended to all people. Of course, he's hoping that Philemon will extend it to Onesimus. But he can't order him or force him to do that. But he's reminding him, as he's reminding all of us as Christians, that this is how we should be treating other people. Paul himself is interceding for Onesimus in this letter, just as Jesus Christ interceded for all of us. Jesus has always been our advocate before the Father. Paul is acting as the advocate for Onesimus before Philemon. So Paul is simply putting into practice the love that he learned when he learned the gospel and he came to accept the love and grace of God through Jesus Christ. And also Paul demonstrates a sacrificial love for Onesimus because he even offers to cover any debts that Onesimus might have incurred that he perhaps could owe Philemon. Now, as Joan said, and that's correct, Philemon was a wealthy man. Paul was not a wealthy man. You know, Paul wouldn't have had many means to try to actually physically repay Philemon for anything that Onesimus causes, but he makes that effort. He says, I will be good for anything that Onesimus owes you. You know, don't worry. If he has any debts, if he has anything that he owes you, I will be good for it. You know, if he's in prison, I don't know how he's going to do it. But he says he will. I mean, he's making that effort. He's making that point to Philemon. He says, basically, charge it to my account. You know, if he owes you something, just put it on my tab. Put it on my account. I will take care of it. And so he won't have to owe you anything. Well, if you think about it, isn't that what our Savior Jesus Christ did for us? Covers all of our debts. He says, oh, I'm going to wipe those away. Your sins, your debts, your trespasses, I'll take them on myself and take care of that. So Paul is exhibiting here how Jesus really gives us an example of how we should be relating to not just God, but to all other people. It's sort of amazing letter, a short letter that you can read all these things into it. You can see how the love of Christ permeates and transforms how Christians should act toward each other, how we should be living together with one another. Final thing I have to say this morning, these aren't my words, these are actually Martin Luther's words, not Martin Luther King Jr. This is Martin Luther. We predated him by several hundred years. This is Martin Luther, known as the father of the Reformation. He actually wrote several commentaries on different parts of the Bible, and one of his most famous commentaries is on this book of Philemon. And Martin Luther's commentary on Philemon was about 10 times the length of the actual book. But anyway, you can probably guess that. How can Pastor Steve stand up here and preach on that? It's only 25 verses. But anyway, this is what Martin Luther had to say about Philemon. A little bit of what he had to say, I'm certain what we don't think. Martin Luther said, and I quote, This epistle gives us a masterful and tender illustration of Christian love. For here we see how St. Paul takes the part of poor Onesimus, and to the best of his ability, he advocates his cause with his master. He acts exactly as if he were himself Onesimus who had done the wrong. Yet he does this without force or compulsion, as lay within his rights, but he empties himself of his rights in order to try to compel Philemon also to waive his rights. What Christ has done for us with God the Father, St. Paul is also doing for Onesimus with Philemon. For Christ emptied himself of his rights and overcame the Father with love and humility, so that the Father put away his wrath and his rights and received us into favor for the sake of Jesus Christ, who so earnestly advocates our cause and heartily takes our part. For we are all his Onesimuses, if we believe. End quote. Fairly poetic way that Martin Luther had of saying that we are all God's Onesimuses. We have all done wrong, but it is Christ who has interceded for all of us. And this is how we should be interacting with our fellow man. So I think this little letter of Philemon gives us a big lesson on how the gospel transforms relationships. These names, Paul, Onesimus, Philemon, we can just as well write the names in of people in this congregation. You know, we could write in Don, Joy, Herb, or Gene. Because it is by God's grace in Christ. But the same spirit of mercy and forgiveness should be alive in each and every one of us who call ourselves Christians. Those bonds of brotherly and sisterly love, and we should be reaching out to our brothers and sisters at all times in the same way that Paul was doing in this letter to Philemon. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us now respond to our word this morning by singing together one of my favorite hymns. We sang one of John's favorite hymns last Sunday. This is one of mine. Blessed be the tie that binds. So it's found on page 426 of your hymn. Let us now rise together, either body or spirit, and sing.
Thank you.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We now come to that point in our service where we have an opportunity to give of the many ways in which we have been blessed in our lives. So as our ushers come forward and we hear our special music this morning, please be generous in your gifts. Let us pause now for just a moment of silence as we prepare our hearts and minds for prayer. Shall we pray? Almighty God, we look to you not only as our great example, but also as our constant companion. When we feel lonely, when our human relationships produce pain, when we find ourselves at our most unlovable, you remind us that we are your children. We are the recipients of your unconditional love and your perpetual presence in our lives. As your children, we want to be a loving people, our God, a people who are known by our love for you and by our love for our neighbor. As such, we come alongside those that we know to be in need. This day, we want to pray for all those who have been mentioned in this service and for all those who often go unnamed but are in our thoughts, in our minds, and in our prayers. We ask that you be with them, our God, you support them, and may your love and strength continue to comfort them. Our God, we seek healing and wholeness in our own relationships and in our world. We want to pray for all those whose lives have been so rudely interrupted by severe weather, and for those who are tasked with meeting the incredible needs that these storms create. And we pray for those who are striving to ensure that the next meal for their children is there. And for all those who are in both physical and mental pain. We pray for those who desperately need to develop a relationship with you and with their fellow people. We ask that you help them to know the gospel, to know you, our God, through the efforts of your children, through us, when the opportunity arises. Use us as vessels of your love and grace. Continue to be with us now, our God, as together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us now rise one last time, either in body or in spirit, and sing our closing hymn, which is found on page 656 of your hymnal, Take Time to Be Holy, shall we rise together.
Thank you.
reach out to your brother and sister in Christly love, mercy, and forgiveness. And also remember, next Saturday, be right over here next door at the Silversmith's house for the open house. I mean, we've been talking about this for years, so how can you miss it? You can come out and go through it. Spend a few minutes and look through the house. Of course, if you can't make it next Saturday, you're always welcome to open the Silversmith's house as well. Who knows? You may be starting a ministry there. I have no idea how we may know. We do know, of course, that our food pantry is going to move over there into the back of the house, and that our youth ministry is going to be moving into the top floor of the house over there. Other than that, we're open to God's guidance in terms of how that house is going to be used, and it's going to be there, so we are knowing that God will find ways for it will to be used for God's people. So it's exciting. I hope you can be there on Saturday. But if you can't, you can still check it out. It'll be all right. The following Saturday, be there for the fish fry. I'll talk a lot more about that next week as I get ready for that. I'm not really in the mood for that yet. We're almost there. We're about to get there. Hopefully, most of the rain has passed away and you won't have to go out and get drenched. As we go outside, I see many of you have your umbrellas, so you're prepared. I left mine in my truck, of course. It wasn't raining when I came in, so didn't need an umbrella. So it's raining now. I'll get wet, but I'll have to manage with that, I guess. I hope you have a great week. I hope things go very well for you this week. But I want you to always remember that God is always there with you. Because, you know, God is always above us to protect us. God is always below us to support us, to hold us up. God always goes before us to guide us. God is always behind us. God always has our backs. God is always beside us to support us, to help us, or anything that we need. And most importantly of all, God is always inside us as well. God's love, God's joy, God's mercy, God's forgiveness is with us at all times. And I hope it flows out of you this week to all that you come in contact with. So go in peace this week.